What's the hardest part about being a real estate agent? It's finding clients. Mm-hmm. And we solve that problem. We call them as a client, right? As a cash buyer. So a lot of these agents that, you know, may not be so happy to talk to us, but it's like, hey, we're actually calling you and you've put yourself out here. I'm calling your phone number off Google and you're a licensed agent here in Phoenix. I'm looking to buy a house in Phoenix. So we do solve that hardest problem of being an agent.
You're listening to the AZREIA Show. If you're looking for quality real estate investing information that you can trust, you've found it. Stay tuned and join the tens of thousands of members that have already benefited from AZREIA, your home for education, market information, support, and networking opportunities that will advance your real estate investing career.
Welcome to another AZREIA Show. My name is Mike Del Prete, Executive Director of AZREIA, and we have a very special guest, and I'm going to say it right, Luke Careccia. Welcome, buddy. We're going to talk all things real estate today. I had the honor to be on his podcast a month or so ago. So what's the name of your podcast?
It's called Young Money Mindset.
All right. So check that out. We'll drop that in the link below. But today, investor-to-investor, real estate conversation. Let's kick it off, Luke. Tell us about yourself.
Yeah, man. I appreciate you having me on.
Yeah, man. Let's do it.
You know, I love what you guys have going on over here at AZREIA and grateful to be a part of it. So, yeah, man, just really, I got into real estate pretty young age, 17, 18, got licensed, didn't really have a whole lot of direction. And, mm-hmm. you know, before that, you know, had my trials and tribulations, you know, as a kid growing up, was kind of like that. You know, I don't want to say outcast, but just kind of that kid that, you know, was just, you know, living life and not maybe taking schoolwork as serious as I should. Yeah. And, you know, had a pretty bad deal with, you know, my dad and my stepmom when I was 17. They both got murdered.
Wow.
Yeah. So that was like my junior going into senior year of high school. And that was big, you know, as a 17-year-old kid, man, like your parents are your world, you know, and, So I just turned 26.
All right.
So it's been about 9 years. But yeah, man, I just, you know, I was lost. I just 17, 18, just didn't really have any direction. You know,
did you have family and stuff like to lean on a little bit? Or
I mean, I did, yeah. Like my relationship was with my dad.
It doesn't matter, right?
Was like, yeah. I mean, we were like best friends, man. Mm-hmm. Like we spent, my dad took me everywhere. I mm-hmm. love that you took your son into, you know, when you did our podcast. Yeah. It just kind of reminded me of that. Like I was always welcome. You know, every time he hung out with his friends, I was mm-hmm. always there. Like he was never that person that was like, oh, let me get a babysitter. It was like, no, you're coming with, you're going to learn some stuff. So, man, I just, a lot of my success, I owe it to him and just his leadership and mentoring at a young age. But going into senior year, you know, just didn't really have that direction. So luckily I kind of stumbled into sales. And didn't go to college, and I actually studied. There's a local dealership here called Ride Now Power Sports. Mm-hmm. It's like a motorcycle dealership, and I studied all about that company, and went in there at 18, and was trying to get a job in the front of the house. They call it like the sales department. And a lot of the guys my age were going into service or lot tech, and kind of, you know, trying to build in. And you know, luckily I got an opportunity to jump straight into sales at 18, and ended up running a small team over there for a few years, and then got recruited out of that position and got into door to door.
So real quick, so in that phase, so very young, right? Like, so most people at that age are partying or you said college or whatever it is, right? So it's like, so obviously you said your dad gave you leadership or mentorship, right? Was he in business?
No.
Or any sort? Or
no, he was.
Just a good figure, good father figure?
Yeah, he was just awesome. A good father figure. He was a pilot.
Oh, awesome. So I'm thinking, like, to go be a go-getter and, like, I studied this company.
Yeah.
And, like, that's where I'm getting at. Like, what made you say, like, I have to study this company. I got to go try to get a job and sell. Like, what
It's really just out of necessity, man. Yeah. You know, you take mm-hmm. a 17, 18-year-old kid that's got no direction. I mean, I've been on my own literally since 17, 18. And that's a young age to really be learning not only about yourself, but then also have that pressure of, you know, growing up, like, overnight, you know, like, okay, hey, now it's rent and electric bills and insurance and, you know, gas. And so it was really just out of necessity, you know, I had to, and that's why I did it. It wasn't that I was like some genius or smart guy. Yeah. I just leaned into it, and luckily people saw that. And I try to tell people, like, you know, I go into my high schools, and I've been fortunate enough to get out there and be speaking in high schools now. And, you know, I tell some of the younger generation, especially in that high school, you know, age, getting out of high school, like, people are going to respect that hard work. And, you know, they see sometimes themselves in you at a young age, and they remember what it's like getting into a career or an industry or whatever it is. So don't be afraid to get out there and put yourself out there, even though you might not be the most skilled. Or, you know, I talk to some people like, I don't feel like I'm old enough to get into real estate, or people aren't going to take me serious. But really, people are going to respect it, is what I've found.
So what about a lot of kids, you know, they might not have their back against the wall. So what can you advise them? Like, what do you advise them in that situation? Like, great, they're not in this, you're in a tough spot. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Unfortunately, so it's like, a lot of these kids got it maybe a little more comfortable. So what, they should still get into it, though.
Yeah.
They should still have that drive.
Yeah, no, and I think there's nothing wrong with that. And I've been thinking a lot about that question now that I have a daughter of my own, you know, and, you know, how she's going to grow up. But I think it really just comes down to not being afraid of failure, you know, and being okay jumping out of that nest and failing, you know, and just coming to grips with that. I think that the earlier and the younger you can come to grips with, you know, the idea that, hey, I'm going to probably fail at a lot of things in life. And, you know, my parents are here, and I'm fortunate and grateful to have a good support system that's going to be able to pick me back up. That's a huge benefit in itself. So you can kind of look at that as a positive versus, you know, the other side of it. When you don't have it, you don't have that support. You may not have that safety net. So it creates that pressure.
Yeah, man. When I started, it was like, I started when I was 30, and it was like old man sport. Like, you retire and you invest, play around in real estate. So, like, I wish you started when I was 30. I'm like, all right, whatever, you know? And now it's like seeing guys like yourself or 17, 18 starting at that age, man. How did that, it amazes me, right? So, like, how, I always tell my son, I was like, you can start doing this business now, and you could be hiring your friends by the time they're out of college. Like, what do you think about that? Like,
I've done it.
Yeah, you're doing it, actually. Let's talk about that.
Yeah, so
I jumped the gun there. So, yeah, so you built a sales team. You were actually in a leadership position at a very young age, so you're a go-getter. So, yeah, so how did that transition from – sounded like you had a good career going. So how did real estate
get in the mix? I mean, so I got out of the dealership world. A guy, I'll never forget it, he walked into the dealership and he wrote a check for, I think, $35,000 and bought a side-by-side, a Polaris Razor, an off-road machine. And I was a door-to-door guy, and ended up recruiting me. He was like, hey, man, like, there's, you know, a lot of opportunity to grow and learn about how to sell. And especially at the door, it's a whole type of different, you know, environment to be in and selling. So,
well, you said door to door, so you were working at the bike shop, up as a sales,
in sales. And then he came in and bought that Polaris Razor cash, and he was in door to door, and I ended up quitting there
work for him. Got it.
And I worked for him ever since. It was like that movie, Wolf of Wall Street. He's like, you show me a check right now for 30 grand, I quit my job and I work for you. And and it worked out that way. And he ended up being a great mentor.
What kind of sale? What were you selling?
So I was selling satellite TV door to door.
All right. How long ago was that?
Man, this was about 5 years ago.
Satellite TV.
Yeah, 5-6 years ago.
All right. So how long did you do that for?
So I did that for about a year and a half, when I was still kind of dabbling in the real estate space too and trying to figure that out.
So you were in the bike sales. So you were in store where the company brought the leads into you and you had to sell. And then you had to go cold turkey into, you know, going out, so out to the people and knocking on the door and getting, what is the major difference in between those?
Yeah, I mean, I think that
some learning lessons.
Yeah, I mean, I think the door-to-door side has taught me a lot about just the constant rejection. It's different when you're knocking on someone's door for them to tell you no than for them to walk into your place of business and then walk out. It's just a different type of rejection. So it just, it really taught me to get comfortable with that rejection. And also it thickens your skin in a sense that, you know, the amount of times people have said, oh, go get a real job, or, you know, listen, you're never going to be successful. Why are you knocking on my door, mm-hmm. calling you all sorts of names? It really gave me a burning passion. It kind of put a chip on my shoulder,
okay.
if I'm being honest, to get out there and prove these guys wrong, man. Because it's like, you know, I'm just a guy out here trying to make a living, right? Yeah. Like, I was a younger guy just literally trying to make a living. And it just taught me a lot about that.
So going from a business that you get a check probably with commissions,
yep.
you went straight no commission, just knocking on doors. So, yeah, that was another risk you took.
Yeah.
You're right? Like,
yeah.
So then you're knocking doors selling satellite. Did that just kind of phase out because of the product, or did you go right into real estate from there?
No, I mean, they did it for a while. A lot of my buddies transitioned out of that and got into solar and started selling solar and having a lot of success with that. I always just loved real estate. I always, you know, saw the guys, and I'll, you know, there's guys here in the Valley, you know, that I grew up literally watching on mm-hmm. Instagram and Facebook and, you know, wherever I could get my hands on it. And I just love the idea of being able to take control of my finances. And I think real estate was so attractive for me because at a young age, I didn't have that control of my finances. I was mm-hmm. always at the whim of, man, like, I got to pay rent and I got roommates and we got this and that. So I just naturally kind of got, you know, gravitated more towards the...
So it was more social media just exposed. It wasn't like, hey, my mentor's flipping houses or has a couple rentals. It was just more you searching and being aware.
Just kind of getting aware of it. And then once I really decided, like, hey, I want to do this real estate thing, I bought every T-shirt, every lanyard, every mm-hmm. little thing, poster. I used to have people come over to my house, like, why do you have a brokerage poster, like, you have a poster of a brokerage here in town, okay. And it's like, I just immersed myself into it. And
I didn't even ask, is this all in Phoenix?
All here in Phoenix. So it was just,
you're obsessed.
Yeah, just get obsessed. Yeah, exactly.
There you go. I can tell. All right, so you're obsessed with real estate. You're scrolling. You got brokerage signs on your window, and so what was the first step into real estate? Like, what was the first action you took?
So I got my real estate license.
Okay.
Just because I didn't really know that you could do it without a license.
True.
So I got that license and then ended up, you know, joining a team and being around some really great guys here in the Valley that kind of more or less took me under their wing. And I think they saw a lot of just that obsession and that hustle. And one thing I look for now is what I call the uncoachables. I can teach you how to sell real estate and how to comp deals, but I can't teach you how to cold call 9 hours a day, right?
Yeah.
So, I was just grateful to be around good guys that noticed that in me at an early age and started pouring into me and teaching me how to become a traditional real estate agent.
Got it.
And just built my business really on Mojo Dialer. The triple line Mojo dialer.
That's right. Yeah. Remember Mojo. It's still around probably too.
Yeah.
You guys still use it in your company now?
We do. Yeah. Okay. We dial a lot out of our CRM now.
Got it. So real estate agent, how long did you do that for?
I still do it. Still, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Are you still like showing clients, listing houses or?
Yeah. You know, I've kind of leveraged and outsourced some of that now. And, you know, I've got an assistant that'll help me show houses or, you know, I'll still go on a lot of listing appointments.
Okay.
So I just got my real estate broker license.
Oh, good for you.
So I just, you know, always been trying to take that education to the next level while being able to still serve clients. Especially with the NAR stuff going on right now.
Oh, yeah, a whole nother ballgame.
Yeah, so there's a lot to learn, and I've been focused on that and then making sure my clients are taken care of. But that's really the start of my real estate career is that Mojo Dialer and being a traditional agent.
So what brought you into the investing side of things?
So I was really focused traditionally for about 2 years. Didn't do any investments, no wholesaling, no fix and flip, nothing. And really, it was a money constraint. I just did not have the resources to do it. And then I started kind of being a little bit more strategic with the way I was spending my funds and investing more into education and learning, hey, what is this wholesaling thing? And you know, what are these fix and flips? How do you do them? How do you buy rentals? And then about 2 years in, I did my first flip. Mm-hmm. And
how'd you find it?
Cold calling.
Cold calling. So were you cold calling for real estate agent work?
Yeah.
And kind of pivoted? All right, cool.
Yeah, so I built my entire traditional side on cold calling canceled expireds off the MLS on Mojo. So that's how I got a lot of my clients. And then this gentleman, Lance, I'll never forget him, called me from California, never met him. He came out, hey, you know, unfortunately my sister passed. We need to sell her house. And
this is the guy you met at Mojo.
Yep.
Okay.
Or I never met him. I cold called him.
Cold called him. He's in California. Yeah. Canceled expired list.
Yep.
And he called. Okay. So, all right.
So his sister passed and I built a great relationship with him, was following up with them, and his sister passed. I went out, toured the house for him and sent a video over to Lance, and he's like, man, I did not know that's how my sister. He was heartbroken. Like he was devastated to see, you know, the final years of his sister's life and just the condition she was living in. Mm-hmm. He's like, none of us knew. And he was, you know, a well-off guy in California, and his sister was here, and they have kind of lost contact. And, you know, he said, Luke, I'm not coming out there, man. I'm not getting this house ready. I don't want to deal with it. It just breaks my heart seeing it on this video. What can I do? And at that moment, I didn't really know what to do. I went to my mentor and said, hey, I got this listing. You know, the guy's doesn't want to get it ready. And I mean, I can't list it like this. It's bad. I mean, you could barely breathe in this house with just the way the conditions were. So we ended up working out a deal, making him an offer, and he was ecstatic with it. So we ended up buying it, flipping it, and selling it, and just learned so much about the fix and flip business.
Yeah.
Just from that single deal. And anyone out there is like, that one deal can teach you so much about fix and flips.
So let's talk about that. So you're cold calling for your real estate agent business. You come across a situation, which is common. So for those like new to the business, that's what we look for, problems associated with properties. So not every house agents can list, nor does the agent, like in your experience at that time, you didn't know what to do with it.
Yeah.
So building relationships with agents is crucial as real estate investors, your network, right? So so who helped you out? Was it someone did you partner up? Like, what was the partnership like, mentorship, when it came to flipping that house?
Yeah, so I was on a local team here, and what ended up happening is we did a split. I think I got, I don't know, 30-40% of the net profit or something. I really, at that time, it was, as much as I was focused on living, I was never focused on, hey, I need to make X amount of dollars. I was always more focused on the knowledge. What can I learn? Mm-hmm. You know, how can I provide value to this guy so he can make money and I can learn? And I think that has really helped me kind of jumpstart my career too, because I know a lot of people that come out of the gate and like, I want to make X amount of dollars and I want to partner with you and I want 60% of the profits. I want this, this, and that. But I think if you flip that model around and really lean into the value side like I did, you're going to end up learning more. And that's exactly what I can't even tell you the exact dollar amount I made on it. I want to say probably 30, 40, maybe we split it. But yeah, I mean, I learned just so much about managing crews and just all the nitty gritty details. And
well, you learn there's a whole nother world out there.
Yeah.
Which obviously you lean more into.
Yep.
So, you kept, what'd you do after that flip? Did you just, you know, just start exploring new options in wholesaling and flipping, or what was your thoughts?
You know, it was cool and I enjoyed it, but I was so focused on my traditional real estate business. I was scared to get into the investing because all I knew was, hey, Cole, canceled expired, go out, meet him, you know, build a rapport, have them fall in love with you, show your value and list their home and get them top dollar. Mm-hmm. So that's all I did. And I was timid to branch out of that and say, man, I don't have this money. How am I going to go and tell this guy I'm going to buy this house cash? Like, I don't have that money. And so it took me a little while. It probably took me another 6 months to a year to really wrap my head around what I just did and really extract those lessons out of that process and figure out what did I really learn? Because at the moment, there's so much stuff going on.
Oh, yeah.
You kind of leave thinking, oh, yeah, I learned something. But, like, until you have that time to really reflect on, okay, I learned it's the hardest part. One of the hardest parts is managing the contractors and their schedule and, you know, dealing with humans and just doing that. So yeah, anyways, I really just kind of focused more on the traditional side, and then about 12 months later, really started leaning more into wholesaling and pushing that needle forward on growing that side of the business.
So who got you into that? What did you get, a coach, mentor, or you just did it yourself?
I did it all myself, man. Yeah, all right. just really you know, doubled down. I mean, I watched a lot of stuff on YouTube. You know, all the guys on YouTube. Jerry Norton was a big one that I watched. But yeah, just really started kind of focusing on how to acquire it, what my dispositions look like, and figuring out what are buyers really buying at, and trying to stay objective. And that's the biggest thing that I've really focused on, is staying objective.
So what was your approach as an agent? Did you just kind of cold turkey the agent, or were you just playing like a dual approach? Like, let me just talk to this lead. I got multiple skill sets now. Maybe I could wholesale it. Maybe I could list it. How did you take that approach?
Yeah, I really, I try to do a lot of like what we call like a takeaway in a sense. Like, I don't like to wear the two hat mentality. I used to do that.
Okay.
But what I found by doing that was I was sitting at the table usually with someone that was telling me they wanted, you know, top dollar for their house, but then they also wanted all the benefits of selling it to an investor, right? So they wanted cash, they wanted a two-week close, they wanted to sell it as is. And I was kind of stuck in this kind of weird position between being their agent and having to tell them, like, you know, it's very difficult to have both of those, right?
Yeah,
like, you know, in order for me to get you top dollar, like, there's some things we need to do. And that's just me being honest with you. And I've always operated out of a place of transparency and honesty. And I've lost a lot of business because when I would tell people, you know, hey, if you want to get top dollar and you know, you don't want to have to do anything, like, those two things don't really jive. We need to get it on the market. We need to do this, this, and this. And then the next person would say, oh no, we'll get you cash in 2 weeks, and they'd list it and sit on the market for 90 days.
Yep.
So what I started doing moving forward is I really went in just as kind of an open book, meaning, you know, hey, these are the skill sets that I offer, but really I got better at listening and writing down in my book of, hey, what are their problems? And I think with listening, one thing that's really helped me is, like, we all say we're great listeners, or we all try to think that, hey, I know I could do that. But until you jot it down and you really take that time to reflect on what that person's saying, then you can really provide that solution. So I try to get better at listening and then trying to lean into what way we were going to go.
Yeah, listening opens up a lot of doors.
Yeah.
It really does, man. All right, so that's a good skill set to share. So when did the wholesaling really start to kick off?
Yeah, so, I mean, after that, I started scaling the wholesaling side, started building that out, brought in a couple acquisition guys. You know, one of them is still, you know, side by side with me about 3 years later. And yeah, we just really started growing, you know, started growing the wholesale side. And I actually got into we used to do a lot of direct to seller, you know, like the cold calling, cancel expireds. But I pivoted towards the agent referral model.
All right. Tell us about it.
And the agent referral model really is, you know, when you go into my office and you see my team, a lot of people think, oh, you guys are calling, you're the guy that calls me trying to buy my house.
Mm-hmm.
And we're not calling direct to seller. We're calling agents.
Oh,
and
okay.
that's what we do 9 hours a day, is we cold call real estate agents.
So, okay, so let's start with that. So you're just, that's your main source of leads.
Yep.
Is referrals from agents.
Yeah.
No direct mail, no PPC, no paper lead, nothing. Just no cold. Okay, awesome.
Yeah.
All right. So what are you saying to these agents? What's your proposition there?
Yeah, I mean, our main one is just, you know, trying not to call and ask for something versus calling to provide them, you know, either a value or, you know, a value proposition or a service. So that's really what I've taught my team. And one way we do that is we call and we tend to offer our opportunities to them first.
Okay.
So, like, for example, I'm flipping a house in Mesa right now, off market. No one knows about it. So kind of how that call looks is, you know, Michael, I, you know, it looks like you work with clients here in the Mesa area. You know, we actually have an opportunity coming up. It's off market. It's going to be fully remodeled, somewhere right around that 400 number. Do you happen to have any clients here maybe looking for a 3-bed, 2-bath with a pool around that 400,000? And some agents, you know, will take you up on that, and they see the value, and wow, okay, that's even great. Even if my client doesn't like it, I can still send them an opportunity where it's a fully remodeled house before it hits the market. And then that way, you know, we're not just calling asking for something.
So you're bringing any type of deal that might be in your pipeline to them, whether whether it's a listing or an off-market deal. So you're calling agents, bringing something up front first. Absolutely. And what's the next part of the conversation look like?
So then the next side is really just kind of leaning into, you know, what value we provide. Mm-hmm. And I'm a big believer in people, when they pick up the phone, there's three things you got to tell them: who you are, why you're calling, and what's in it for them. And those three things are typically you can do in a short amount of time. The shorter amount of time you can do that and articulate it well, the more likely they are to stay on the phone, and you can start having that conversation. So our value is, you know, we're cash buyers, close as is, you know, 10 to 14 days. And one thing we've done recently that we've seen a lot of success in is just jacking our EMD up a lot, just because of the competition here in Phoenix. I mean, we could be competing against 4, 5, 10 other investors, for example. So as a traditional agent, you know, putting yourself into that mindset, or sitting down with a client saying, hey, this offer here, they're offering $10,000 in earnest money, sometimes is more appealing to a seller versus the guy that's doing
$3,000.
And folks in real estate know it's not, really doesn't change a whole lot on our end.
You got your inspection period, you're getting it. Well, it's a good point, though, because, but like you said, you like to motivate and inspire the younger crowd, right? They're going $10,000. What? Where do I even, like, what do I do it? How do I get that? What do you mean? And I got to risk it, and I don't even know how I'm going to get it back. So what do you say to that person?
Yeah, so I think you really need to know your contracts. You know, you got to know your contracts, like you said. Your inspection period, I mean, even if I waive the inspection period, we have 5 days from the receipt of the seller property disclosure statement, I can get my earnest money back. I have 5 days from the title commitment. So you got to really study your contracts and know what risks you're taking. And then on the flip side, if you, let's say I lock up a deal and I don't have the $10,000, but it's a good deal, I can almost guarantee you, you're going to find a whole end buyer out here in the valley that will buy that and say, hey, you know, on this one, we had to increase our earnest money to get the deal. You know, make sure you really want it. Mm-hmm. And would you mind, rather than putting 5 in EMD, would you mind doing 10?
There you go.
And 9 times out of 10, these guys aren't going to have a problem with it. If they're buying the house, they're typically in a position to put a little bit more earnest in, or they can get it, you know, you can structure that. There's gator lenders out there now. Mm-hmm. There's guys lending money for earnest money. So there's a lot of different ways you could get the money, but that's really kind of helped us. And as small as that sounds, it's incredible how much of a difference sometimes it makes.
Does. It really does. Just to make sure you want to do whatever you can to stack the cards on your side to make your offer look stronger, right? So how are you getting – so you're calling agents, though. So it's like, what are you doing? How can people get all these real estate phone numbers? Where are you getting the phone numbers?
I mean, the nice thing with real estate agents is all their info is public, right? And what's the hardest part about being a real estate agent? It's finding clients, right? Mm-hmm. And we solve that problem. We call them as a client, right? Yeah. As a cash buyer. So a lot of these agents that, you know, may not be so happy to talk to us, but it's like, hey, we're actually calling you – and, you know, you've put yourself out here. I'm calling your phone number off Google.
Yeah.
And, you know, you're a licensed agent here in Phoenix. I'm looking to buy a house in Phoenix, you know?
Yeah.
So we you know, we do solve that hardest problem of being an agent.
What are some tips, though, for the newer person, maybe? Like, they want to take your advice. Because when me and you call an agent, it's going to be different than it would be a newer person calling, right? They're going to be script reading and not knowing all the little flows and angles to keep the conversation going.
Yeah.
Any tips on that end?
Yeah, I think one thing we do when you join the Thrive Real Estate team is, you know, we have 100 vocabulary terms that we have you learn. Because when you call an agent, right, I get these calls. I'm sure you've gotten them. I know immediately, not only if you're reading off a script, I mean, that's there's ways you can kind of go about
seconds.
That.
Like, yeah. Literally seconds, you're like, okay.
Yeah. But even just the, because what sometimes happens is that you get pulled off script and then you don't know the vocab, right? You don't know these terms and these things agents are throwing, especially real estate agents, because it's not like calling a seller where they're not going to know, you know, all they know is, hey, contract price, you know. So, but when you're calling agents, typically there's a little bit of a vocab learning, you know, curve there. So we have you study. I would recommend that you study. You know, go pull 100. You can Google it. You know, go pull 100 most frequent terms, you know, real estate agents use and learn those. So if it gets brought up in a conversation, you know what a binzer is, or you know what an inspection is, or you know what an appraisal is. These are just some of the things. Another tip that I'll leave you guys with is really finding out what that agent's looking for. So if you call an agent and they're in a luxury, you know, maybe they're a luxury agent, you know, they might not come across, you know, a $300,000-$400,000 house in Phoenix, because that's just not their cup of tea, right? That's not what they're focused on. So really just trying to qualify that agent. And as much as usually you're qualifying them, they're qualifying you. So, and being okay too with that, that's another thing on that end, is not every agent's going to be a good agent to work with.
Yeah, I know. It's like it, in the beginning, you could be a little intimidated about talking to agents because just limited beliefs, like I'm new, you're saying all this type of stuff. So just get out there and call. It's just going through that. And just like you, when you start or learn anything, you got to go through that initial phase to get through the hurdles. We call it get the marbles out of your mouth.
Yeah.
Right. So you just got to get out there, get it out. You'll just get better. So love it, man. So you're having, are you using like Dr. Bill's list or anything like that? Have you, you downloaded that?
I have. I bought that one a while back. I bought a list, I think, in Indiana or Ohio.
Got it. Got it.
And we had some decent success with that. But
a lot of it is the office number. Or so you're just pulling right off MLS, probably just scrubbing all that, right?
Yep.
So you're calling them, you're bringing them deals. So what else? What else goes on in your businesses? Tell us about like what do you got going now?
Yeah. So now, I mean, really, what I'm focused on is building the wealth of our team, and I think that is what makes a wholesale company or a wholesale team so interesting. Is, you know, you do have access to off market deals discounted. Mm-hmm. So as much as we love wholesaling and we love for our guys on our team to take them down, or to add them into their rental portfolios. And maybe a deal that you come across, Mike, isn't a good deal, or maybe you're not ready to buy it, but you know I am, or vice versa. So I've been really focused in on coaching and training, not only the real estate side, but also the money management side.
Okay.
You know, and understanding, like I tell every person that I meet, like you should have 6 bank accounts. And I know it sounds silly, but it's like, every successful person that I've ever talked to and that's been honest with me, you know, about their financials usually has a handful of accounts. And especially in real estate, because, and especially with, you know, people that start gaining some traction in their business, you start to spend money differently. Mm-hmm. And when you can feather that money out and hide this money, it just ties into the psychology side. So I've been really, really focused on that. Of course, we're always focused on finding the next deal. You know, that never goes away. That's always a constant pressure.
How are you guys dispoing them? So you're locking up a deal, whether through some type of agent relationship. Are you dispoing it through agent relationships as well, or do you have a cash buyers list?
What
do you
Yeah, doing? I've built a cash buyers list.
Got it.
So I've spent a lot of time and energy on building that list out and vetting it and turning it upside down and shaking it out and doing everything I could to try to have a good list. And I'm doing all the dispo right now. So
how do you build a good list?
Yeah, I think it really is just relationship. As much as everyone wants to say they're a cash buyer, I think it really is dependent on relationships. Because and really too, the big thing on lists, I think in just my experience, is you can't send deals out that are not deals. I mean, once you start doing that, you're gonna burn a lot of your cash buyers list. Yeah. So you got to really, you know, treat that list sacred and only send things out that you think are really, really going to pencil. And, you know, if you are out there building a list, maybe send it to a buddy, you know, send it to, you know, someone, a mentor or someone, and have them look at it and say, man, what am I off on this one? Is it good? Should I shoot this out? Because as soon as you start sending stuff out that's not deals, what's going to happen, and they're not going to tell you this, they're just going to quit looking at your deals.
See, I love that you said that, because when I started – it was like you would not send it, one, something you didn't have under contract and hold contract to, and then you didn't send out a bad deal, right? Because word spreads quick, right? Obviously, we've evolved,
yeah,
right? The business in itself. Now it's like you have acquisition companies, you have disposition companies, where when I started, I was A to Z, right? Mm-hmm. So now we have a lot of dispo companies. That's a big trend, right? They just build a massive cash buyers list. They get any deal from people like you and I that go direct, and then they blast that out. Cool. And sometimes it's a numbers game. They have a massive list. They have a good buyers list, and they can throw any deal out there and maybe get a bite on it. But I think times has changed, especially over like the COVID time when it was like California buyers, hedge fund buyers. Like, yeah, anyone could build a massive list and sell it to, you know, yeah, everyone's copy and pasting. You start to build that reputation. I just never was into that.
I wasn't either, and I may be a controversial take, and I don't know, maybe I'll get flamed in the comments for it.
Yeah.
But like, I think the problem sometimes with the dispo companies that I see, and I've seen it firsthand being on the acquisition side, is it works great, right? You can take our deal. We encourage you to take our deal and go send it. And I'll never count the pockets of others. So,
yep, exactly.
You know, whatever you make on it is what you make on it. The one thing though that I see is usually if you have a buyer out there, sometimes what they'll do is they'll get hip to the idea that, man, every deal these guys send me, they're not direct on.
Yeah.
And, man, I could maybe save myself a bit of money. I'm looking at scaling. Maybe I'm going to go from 2 flips a month or 2 flips a quarter to 4 flips.
Yeah.
And, you know, they start running the spreadsheets at their house, and they're like, man, if I call Luke directly and I get on his list, I'm probably going to save myself like 30, 40 grand a month, the amount of deals I buy or whatever that number is. Yeah. So all of a sudden I get a text right at 9 a.m. Hey, Luke, it's so-and-so, this LLC. I've seen your LLC. I've researched it. Mm-hmm. You're usually direct on these. Would you add me to your cash buyers list?
Yeah, man. Like, one, I have an email list that's just all wholesale deals, right? So I go through it, and I see a deal that's interesting. Also, you just search the address, and you see 5 different people. You call the person with the lowest. That type of stuff just happens. And then it's like, yeah, like you said, you start to be the guy known that, or the company that just doesn't lock up deals and are always high. That's a big thing here at AZREIA. All the flippers, landlords are just like, no wholesaler deals, they don't make sense.
Yeah.
But my world is always, you still got to write the offer. So even if you should send me a crappy deal, I'm like, hey, I'll email them and be like, hey, this might not work for you, but I'm at X if you want to close quick. I'll still do that, get the offer out. But and you're wasting a lot of time when I feel as a wholesaler, when you don't, I'm on the front end too. I'm going a lot of different ways, but like wasting time. Like, yeah. I don't know, man. I guess as a dispo company, I guess you could just blast out deals all day and hire someone to do that, but.
Yeah, you can, and it is a strategy, and I mean, I'm not trying to, you know, talk down on the strategy. I think it's a strategy that definitely works. It's just, I try to think of things in a 10-year time frame.
Okay.
And like, as a 10-year time frame, if I do that for the next 10 years, are those buyers still going to be my buyers? Because people, you know, you don't own your cash buyers, right?
Like, buyers go through cycles. Like, they're not always going to be there.
Yeah. So it's, you know, and I think a lot in controlling the contract too, there's value in that.
Your payday.
Yeah, exactly.
It's harder to do. It's probably cost more money to do, yeah. Right? Yeah, there's just so many ways to split this business up, man. So you're dispoing all the deals. So you got, how many people are on your team calling out?
So right now we have about 7.
So 7 people calling out. You still got the 16-year-old guy?
Mm-hmm.
Awesome, man. That's cool.
Yep.
So yeah. 7 people, whatever, calling out, building agent relationships. Who cuts the contract? Do you oversee the final? Like,
yeah. So we have an acquisitions department, and then we have an administrative department that mm-hmm. handles all of our contracts. So if you're on our team, you know, we don't expect our acquisition folks to write the contracts and manage the contracts, because that I've noticed just. You know, I'll be the first one to tell you, I'm not the best person at doing that. Like, I love the sales side, and that's where I know I can make the most amount of money is selling. And that's what I want my team to do. I want my team to be focused on finding the next deal, talking to that agent, providing value, all the things we talk about. So when they get a deal, they, hey, boom, agent's got a deal. They comp it, they underwrite it. They say, hey, this is our acquisition price. We have a system and process in place where they take it, they tag our transaction coordinator in it. She takes it, writes the contract, sends it out, texts them, emails them, calls the agent. This is our offer. Please confirm receipt. Boom. Okay. We're flexible on close. We have a whole little thing we run them through.
Mm-hmm.
And then it goes back on to that acquisition agent to follow that contract.
Got it.
So now they're going to, you know, continuously follow up. A lot of times right now, I mean, June, I read a statistic recently. June was the highest month for cancellations.
Yeah.
We've seen in quite a while in June. So sometimes we'll get beat out. And, you know, it's our expectation on our team that you follow up with that offer and ask the right questions because sometimes they fall through. Then it goes back onto the acquisition person. They follow through. And then as soon as there's some movement on signing or addendums or counter offers, then it volleys back and forth. Then it'll go back to admin. They'll handle it. They'll do their counters, their addendums. And then once it gets all wrapped up, it goes over to another administrator that packages it, and then it goes to me and I dispo it.
Got it. There you go.
Yep,
the whole business in a nutshell.
That's it right there.
There you go, man. So so you got the buyer's list. So what are you seeing in the Phoenix market as we record this? Like, a lot has changed over the last year and a half, 2 years. So what's the buyer world look like? What does it look like to you?
Yeah, I mean, I think I'm always bullish on Phoenix.
For sure.
You know, I think there's an interesting time right now going on, and I think you can look at it a few different ways. I mean, my main takeaways are it's always about price, right? Mm-hmm. And I tell my team and I tell everyone I come into contact with, you know, whether the market goes up, down, sideways, in circles, around and around, it's going to come down to what can I buy it at, what can I sell it at. So I've just been really focused in on, you know, trying to study what the Fed's going to do and try to kind of forecast, hey, what do I think rates are going to do? And then what do I think I can buy this at?
Got it. And well, that's the great thing about wholesaling, right? We're sales.
Yeah.
So we could ride up or we could ride down, wherever it's going. You just got to know where the market's at and where the buyers are at. And what, you know, you got to buy it right all the time. So just to kind of help people out, right? Because everyone gets stuck to the 70% rule or whatever it is, which I don't do. So I always work my numbers all the way down. So where do you think buyers are roughly buying at? Like, is there a percentage that you could throw out there?
There's no percentage. I think that's one of the biggest things that YouTube has done is it's turned a lot of these wholesalers into the 70%, you know, formula guys, right? What we buy a deal at, you know, and you know, Holbrook or Tonopah is different than what we buy a deal in, you know, Old Town Scottsdale. It's just, it's different, right? I think you have to look at it objectively. And that's the main thing I hear when I think about the market is you can't, you know, there's a time and place to speculate on where the market's going to be. And I don't think we're necessarily in a real speculative time where usually the buyers that I see that are actually continuously buying are guys that are pretty objective, right? They're not going to speculate. They're, you know, they need to have some apple to apple comps, you know, closed recently, not outliers, you know, that are true apple to apple. And then they're probably going to be even a little bit more conservative than that comp. Right. Yeah. I think the market kind of goes through cycles where, you know, speculation's on and it's like, you know, kind of like with the crypto space, it's like, things booming and everyone's buying all this, you know, you know, cheap coins and Dogecoin. It's like a joke.
Hey, I got some of those.
Yeah. Well, it's like just real speculative, right? You know, you may have a little extra cash, you throw it in, cool if it goes up, if it goes down. But, you know, the market just kind of ebbs and flows. And I think right now we're in a more of an objective time frame where it's like you can't have outliers and you can't be speculating on future appreciation.
And it's pretty steady.
It is,
you know, which we always say here at Ezria, it's like, that's a good thing. You know, being able to kind of have some type of predictability in your business is always helpful, right? So when it's just kind of steady, I think that always is helpful. But you don't get caught with your pants down. You always got to stick to the fundamentals. Buy right.
Yeah.
You know, that's huge.
Yeah, buy right. And look at creative deals, too. I think that's another big thing right now. I mean, I've built a rental portfolio these last few years solely on being able to look at things objectively and rule out the cash. Like, hey, cash are too low, but let's look at it creatively and just having both those tools in there. Because you do see a lot of deals. I think sellers' expectations are one thing, and obviously investors, like we're saying, are objective and maybe a little conservative. And, you know, it's just, if it's not a cash deal, then go creative, right? Learn that side.
How are you guys seeing that in your deal flow? Are you seeing subject tos, carry opportunities, lease options, all that stuff? All right. Cool. Yep. Are you wholesaling those out, or are you just kind of picking them up?
Usually we try to keep them in-house.
Yeah.
You know, I love the idea of my guys, you know, keeping those. Like, I got a condo right now in Peoria. It's a 1-1 that we're going to buy it for like 10 grand down or something. Nice. So it's like, that is just, sure, we could probably sell it and put 10, 15 on it.
Yeah.
But it's just such a good play, I think, long-term for someone to keep. I keep joking with everyone. I'm like, we're going to do a spiff and give away, you know, half the down payment, mm-hmm. or, you know, catch it up on the next deal or figure something out for someone to keep it.
Yeah, that's amazing, man. Yeah. It's treating your people right. So, all right, so what's the future look like for Luke, man? Where's the Thrive going? Where's Luke going? What's coming up?
Yeah, man, I think really our future plan is, you know, to double down on the, not only our wholesaling, but the rentals. Mm-hmm. I'm a big believer in slow, long-term wealth building, the boring stuff. So
good.
Buying a rental here or there as much as we can. So yeah, future holds, I'd love to have 50 doors. You mm-hmm. know, that's the goal.
Yep.
50 doors. And then continue kind of balancing not only the wholesaling but the flipping, and just being able to build reserves, I think, is the big thing. So that way, if we ever do have a market correction or whatever you want to call it in the future, if I'm watching this back in 5 or 10 years or 3 years, to be in a position to maybe, you know, get a little bit more aggressive in that time, mm-hmm. Versus trying to grow too fast too soon.
I love it, man. I love the way you think, man, especially at your age. I don't think I was even thinking like this at your age. So, no, but what you're saying is the reserves, very important, because what I've learned over the years is there's always a wave. Like, you get, like when the COVID boom or whatever, right? There's always going to be this cool little wave, this little niche that we pick on and we pick up on and we make a bunch of money. But it's the people that spend all that money or live that crazy lifestyle, right, they lose it, and then when that wave is gone, they're back. How do I make money again? I gotta figure something out, back against the wall, right, kind of thing. So it's like every time a wave goes up, stack it.
Yep.
Right, and then everyone's gonna disappear, you're still in the business. So boom, you're in the business long enough, another wave comes, grab it, stack it.
Yep.
You're still, I've been in this for 14 years, and that's how I did it. It was just every wave, just grab the, stack it, save it. You know, you have some fun, don't get me wrong.
Yeah.
But you're on that track, you're thinking right, man, so. Kudos to you, man. That's
thank great. You.
What else you want to share? Anything you want to wrap up with?
Yeah, man. We have a group on Facebook. We'd love for you guys to be a part of it, called the Arizona Real mm-hmm. Estate Investor Forum. We post deals in there. I'm sure, you know, if you ever have a deal you're trying to push or look at some deals, it's hit or miss. You know, we try to keep up on it. So, you know, buy at your own risk in there for sure. I see some of the deals and I'm like, I've seen this deal like 50 other times and this guy took it off this guy's list. That's like, took it off that other 10 guys list and put it on here. So, you know,
do you guys moderate that?
We do. Yeah. We try to do it as much as we can, but yeah, check out the Arizona Real Estate Investor Forum. We're going to have some events coming up. We have an event coming out, September 24th, cool. over at the, you know, here in Phoenix. And, yeah, we're going to, you know, have some guest speakers there and, you probably do a live podcast we've been cool. thinking about. So, and then connect with me on Instagram. That's usually where I'm most active. So follow my page. I'd love to follow you back, and let's do some deals together.
Cool, man. I appreciate you being here, yeah. Luke. Wise young man. Give him a follow. Definitely listen to what he has to say. So that's a wrap for the AZREIA show. Head to AZREIA.org/calendar. Check out all our events, 15 events a month. Anything you need, we got you covered. If you're new to real estate investing, you're trying to figure out where do I go, what do I do next, take our entrepreneurial assessment, AZREIA.org/ESA. What we'll do there is help you figure out, should I be active, fix and flip, wholesale, or should I be passive, maybe like a landlord or a lender? But at least we'll give you the right direction so you can start building out your plan to execute and hit that target. So that's a wrap for the AZREIA show. Thanks again, Luke.
Thank you.
Awesome. Cool. Love it, man.
Thanks for listening to the AZREIA show with your hosts, Marcus Maloney and Mike Del Prete. We hope you enjoyed this episode. If you found this information valuable, head over to AZREIA.org and learn more about our community.